Society is the same as any organism. It's a result of survival of the fittest.
You mean that a businessman who beats down his competitor is only proving that he's more
fit than...
No matter what he does?
Well, his competitor would do the same to him.
That's the law of the jungle, not of civilization.
You can't change an evolutionary process by laws.
It's the system that's wrong, not evolution. The system must be changed. Under a socialist system, we can...
A moment, please. You're going astray, Mr. Johnson. The topic under discussion is labor legislation, not socialism.
I know that, sir, but these problems can only be solved under socialism.
Perhaps, but that's not what we're discussing today.
Yes, sir.
Professor Ely.
Mr. Powers?
Do you believe these problems can only be solved under socialism?
What I believe isn't the issue here, it's what you believe.
Yes, but do you believe it, sir?
You have to make up your own mind, Mr. Powers. That's why you're in college. It's my job to see that you examine all sides of a question.
You will admit, sir, regarding socialism, that this is a dangerous period in our history.
The Depression period is always dangerous.
Is it only the Depression, sir? What about the agitators that come here with foreign doctrines, socialist doctrines? I think your students have a right to know where you stand in this matter.
My books tell where I stand, Mr. Parr. However, if the subject of socialism interests you at the moment, let's plan a discussion period for tomorrow. I listen to debate suggestions. Right now.
Government regulation of private industry, sir.
Very well.
Protection of life, health, education, and general welfare of the workmen by government.
Good.
Government ownership of railways.
I see you've read my books, Powers.
The role of a bold teacher is always a hazardous one, as Professor Richard T. Ely was to discover in 1894. Ely was a leading figure in the field of economics and head of his department at the University of Wisconsin. He taught his students the new ideas that were revolutionizing the field of economics in the last quarter of the 19th century, and he wrote books on some of the most controversial problems. To those who fear change, who are afraid of being exposed to new ideas, Richard T. Ely came to represent a new kind of threat to society. Because of his courage, Richard T. Ely's name would be forever linked with academic freedom in the United States.
Of these Chautauqua lectures, I'd like to summarize. These are the evils of our system, which should be taken care of not only by the state, but by the church, since I believe they're all religious subjects. First, child labor, a growing evil, diminishing in other countries, increasing in ours. Second, the labor of women under conditions that imperil the family. Third, Sunday labor, another growing evil. Fourth, an unfair distribution of wealth. Fifth, the deadly optimism of the day, which aims to retard improvement and blinds us to actual dangers. Our true welfare is not an individual matter, but a social matter. Our weal is the common weal. Our exaltation is the exaltation of others. Their elevation is our enlargement.
I forget to wash my face this morning. You're looking at me as though...
You haven't seen this?
The nation? Well, what's Mr. Godkin thundering against now?
There. That letter signed Oliver E. Wells.
Never heard of him.
He's heard of you.
Professor Ely believes in strikes and boycotts. Justifying and encouraging the one while practicing the other. Who is this Oliver E. Wells?
The superintendent of public instruction for our state, no less. Read on.
Somewhat more than a year ago, a strike occurred in the office of the Democratic Printing Company. An agitator or walking delegate from Kansas City came to counsel and assist the strikers.
According to that, you entertained that walking delegate right in our own house. He was in constant consultation with you.
Well, that's a lie.
It isn't all. There was another strike in another printing office, and you were, and I quote, an abettor and counselor.
Well, that's fantastic.
He also has something to say about your books.
Well, how can he? My books are recommended by the university.
Ah, yes, but only the careful student will discover their utopian, impractical, and pernicious doctrines. Very truly yours, Oliver E. Wells.
My attention has been called to the communication of Mr. Oliver E. Wells in your publication of July the 12th. In which I am accused of opinions which I do not hold and of conduct of which I have not been guilty. I shall expect the nation to give as much publicity to my denial as to the unjust attack.
Who does Ely think owns our university? The people? Or a few radical professors?
Mr. Wells, when and how did you... come to the conclusion that Professor Ely was teaching radical doctrines?
Look at these letters, these telegrams, from all over the state, from honest and patriotic citizens. They're outraged. Outraged by what is being taught in our public institutions.
Aren't these letters and telegrams a direct result of your attack on Professor Ely?
If I've helped awaken people, I'm glad. It proves that Americans are alert to the danger.
These books you speak of, specifically, what is the danger?
He's talking about government ownership of railroads, about anarchy and socialism. I'm shocked by the things I find that are being taught in that university.
And is it true you're going after other professors?
Yes, what about that?
No, boys. Let's be careful what we say and how we say it. I'm not going after anyone. I'm only doing my job. I'm responsible to the voters of this state.
Well, then you are investigating others. Can you give us more names?
I will, at the proper time.
At Professor Ely's trial.
Trial? I never said anything about a trial. That's for the Board of Regents to decide.
These other names... Will you reveal them at Professor Ely's trial?
Yes. I mean, they'll be revealed at the proper time.
Mr. Wells, are you aware that many of Professor Ely's former students hold positions of high trust in business, education?
I do not know that to be a fact.
And that none of these students have ever been accused of being radical?
I do not know that to be a fact either. Gentlemen, I don't see that there's anything more I can say. I'm gathering evidence, that's all. And with the help of other Americans, I hope to do a weeding job on the radical element in our universities. It's my contention that if we protect the unformed minds of our children, we protect the future of our country.
Hear, hear.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
No, I thank you.
Good day.
Good day.
Good day.
Good day. Come by anytime. Anytime.
You're not a reporter.
I didn't say that I was.
Well, whatever you are, the interview's over.
My name's David Kinley.
Sorry. Doesn't ring a bell.
I'm one of Professor Ely's former students.
Oh. I see. In a high position of trust?
I teach at Illinois.
All that you learned from Professor Ely? Did he send you here?
No, I came on my own. You see, I'm still inspired by the teachings of Professor Ely and others like him.
Kinley. I must remember the name. It might very well be that you're the product, Mr. Kinley. The product of Professor Ely's teachings. Maybe you are the showpiece, the result of what can be done to young people.
I came here because I hoped you might be sincere, that you'd made an honest mistake.
I don't make mistakes.
If you don't want to make a mistake, then withdraw your charges.
I'm not withdrawing anything. You've read his books. If he doesn't like it here, why doesn't he get out? We've got too many like him here already.
You never have enough.
Chautauqua.
Stimulating. Come on into the office. I'll tell you about it.
Oh, well, I can't just now. I'm in a hurry.
I thought this was your lunch period.
Well, it is, but I have an appointment with the registrar. I'll see you later. Powers?
Hello, Professor.
Hello, Powers. Have a nice vacation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
See you. How are you?
Very well, thank you, sir. And you?
Oh, well enough.
We're well met. Anna said to be sure to ask if you and Mrs. Bell could come to dinner tomorrow. Actually, I'm looking for the opportunity to ask if you could write a foreword to my new book.
Tomorrow? I think Ruth has something planned. I'm sorry. Some other time, perhaps.
Maybe on the weekend.
Well, maybe, although I've taken to resting up on the weekends. Old age, I guess. Nice to see you back, Ely.
Thank you, sir.
Professor, Mr. Wells charges that you teach socialism and anarchy in your classroom and support it outside the classroom. Would you care to comment on that?
You teach men and women, particularly college men and women. You teach them how to think.
What about socialism?
Socialism is a form of government. They should understand it.
And anarchy?
Anarchy is rebellion against existing forms of government. They should understand its anatomy and its purpose.
Professor, aren't your students influenced by what you teach?
Well, I should hope so. I should hope they're influenced to think for themselves, to develop their own powers of judgment. To do that, you must have complete freedom of inquiry.
You believe, then, that a teacher should be permitted to teach any subject he chooses?
Without that freedom, education in America or anywhere else cannot progress.
But, sir, isn't government ownership of railways considered socialism?
It's considered socialistic.
Protection of health, education, and welfare of the workmen is also considered socialism, is it not?
Call it what you will, but don't deny me the right to teach it. Mr. Wells seeks to deny me that right by shameless slandering of my motives.
Professor, in the manner of speaking, the battle lines between yourself and Mr. Wells seem very clearly drawn, but where does it all go from here?
I challenge him to prove the charges he's made.
You mean a public inquiry?
I don't care how he does it. I challenge him to prove it.
Professor, have you changed your teaching schedule? The subjects, I mean.
I have not and will not. Until Mr. Wells proves his charges, as I'm turned out of this university, I'll continue to teach those things I believe will turn out responsible and well-informed citizens.
Bird doesn't know when to stop, does he? He just put a noose around his neck.
Davis! Well, I haven't seen much of you these past few days.
Oh, busy, busy, busy. Little old bird dog, that's me. This was sent to be my mistake. That transfer student, I think he's yours.
Oh, yes, of course. Sit down a minute.
Oh, no, I can't. I got a million things I got to catch up with.
Davis, I'm only accused of being a socialist. Nobody said anything about leprosy.
What are you talking about?
You know very well. However, if you insist on play acting, you may just as well leave.
I'm sorry.
What's going on around here? I've denied those accusations. What more can you or anyone want of me? I've denied the charges.
Ely, you know how we feel about this.
No, I don't.
Well, the students, they're ready to tear the town apart for you. The faculty...
doesn't want to be tainted.
Well, you're being a bit hard on us, but that's about the size of it.
Look, don't you realize that if I'm slaughtered, you will be too. Along with all the others like us in every university throughout the country.
When you've got to put your job on the line, it's a bit difficult to take the long view.
All right. All right, I'm not going to ask anything of you. Except maybe a little advice. Tell me what's been going on behind this impenetrable wall that's been built up around me. What do you want me to do?
I don't think there's anything you can do. This thing keeps growing and growing. Now the charges against you are being printed in the New York papers. In Chicago, it goes on and on.
I know what's happening outside. I don't know what's going on inside the minds of my friends. I do know that you sit around discussing my misfortune instead of the usual campus gossip. What's the consensus?
Well, we all agree that a public trial would ruin you. And it seems like you'll be called before the Board of Regents.
Fine, I welcome that.
Consider what's stacked against you. State officials, the press, Oliver E. Wells, a politician who'll build a career tramping on your carcass.
I still think they'll need more grounds than the word of a politician.
They'll hang you with your own words. You believe in socialism, don't you?
I believe in Christianity.
Turn your collar around, they may understand. Ely, in a classroom, you're a menace. Oh, and another thing. Once they drive you off this campus, no professor in the country will dare open his mouth with an unpopular opinion.
Well, that's inevitable. From what you say, I will be driven off.
But it needn't be this way.
Well, what other way is there?
Well, you could make some sort of moral protest.
Moral protest?
Yes.
I don't understand what... I do. Of course, it would only take a few minutes to dictate the letter, wouldn't it? Gentlemen, how dare you call me anarchist? How dare you accuse me of corrupting my students? How dare you suggest that I am undermining American institutions. I am angry, gentlemen. Therefore, I make a moral protest. I hereby tender my resignation. So let that be a lesson to you. Sincerely, Richard T. Ely, captain of his fate and master of his soul.
Take it easy. Maybe we're frightened, but we can still think straight. Look, you resign. You can get a job anyplace. There are dozens of universities who would jump at the chance to have you.
I have a job here.
If you stay here, if you allow yourself to be dragged through a public trial, you'll lose any chance of another job.
You're all convinced that I'll be found guilty, aren't you?
I'm convinced of one thing only. You fight this out in the open, you're ruined. Resign. Go away quietly and you're safe.
That's on. I wonder if that's what Oliver Wells is trying to say. demonstration, David. I've told you
they'll pay attention. I can guarantee you.
I will not have this matter turned into a brawl.
We won't make any trouble, Professor. We'll be very peaceful.
I'm sure you intend to be, but I've seen too many student demonstrations.
We promise.
You'll be taking a risk. You can be suspended. Do you know that? I want no one taking risks on my behalf. This matter concerns only me.
You're wrong. You're wrong about that, sir. What's happening to you is happening to others. Dr. Steele at Lawrence Tubbs. Even one of your own students.
Yes, yes, I know about that.
You always said we should speak out, Professor. Well, we think that the trustees of colleges today are not qualified. They donate a lot of money and then try to run the schools as if they were railroads or meatpacking plants.
I'm acquainted with business practice. It happens to be my subject.
Then you can't believe they'd give you a fair trial.
You're a threat to them, Professor.
I believe that the worst thing we can do right now is to be driven by emotion.
I'm sorry. I feel highly emotional about this.
I appreciate that. I'm moved more than I can say by your support. But I happen to be an incorrigible believer in reason and goodwill.
You haven't met Oliver E. Wells.
No, but I hope to.
You mean a public hearing?
I mean a public hearing. Powers.
Hello, sir.
I must confess I'm surprised to find you here.
I was asked to come.
Professor Ely, that Mr. Wells, has asserted in public that most college trustees today are unqualified for their jobs. They donate a lot of money to get into position of strength. They try to run a college as if it were a railroad or meatpacking plant. Now, I was there. You never said anything of the sort.
Noteworthy is the fact that there has not been any student demonstration in support of Professor Ely.
I don't understand it. I don't. How does a thing like this get started?
I think perhaps I do. Get Powers. Bring him here.
You mean your student?
Find him, David. Ask him to come here. I think perhaps a few words of truth from that young man may go a long way towards clearing this up. Well, what is it? Oh, Anna.
It's almost 8 o'clock.
Forgive me for being so late. I was just leaving.
Richard, don't let it do this to you.
It'd be so simple, wouldn't it? I could get a job elsewhere. And in a little while, all this would be forgotten. Is that what you're thinking?
It's getting so you can't tell a friend from an enemy.
If I did leave, at least we'd have some peace.
You know we wouldn't. Not ever.
Anna, I just can't. I've got to stand and fight this. The day this faculty believes only what Mr. Wells believes in and teaches only what Mr. Wells approves of is the day that the word education has no meaning whatsoever in the state of Wisconsin. Talk about a pernicious doctrine. If Oliver Wells had had his way 20 years ago, Darwin's theories could never have been taught on this campus. If he gets away with it once, if he convicts me just by accusing me, then he'll do it to others.
Can you stop him?
I'm going to try, and I'll start with young Powers. If I can convince Powers that Wells is distorting the truth, I'm sure I can convince others. Is Powers willing to come and see me?
He's gone.
Gone? Where?
Left the university. And you can look forward to another surprise in the next edition of the newspapers. Seems that Powers' father has written a public letter to President Adams saying he's taking his son out of college. Because they're anarchists on the faculty.
Do you know how Wells was elected, Richard? The Democrats were about to adjourn the 1892 convention when someone discovered they hadn't nominated a state superintendent. So, somebody called out the name of Oliver E. Wells. And he was nominated. When the Democrats swept the state, he was swept right along. Nobody knew who he was. Now we know. Richard, I asked you to come here because I'm deeply distressed at what is happening and what is about to happen.
I know that, sir. And I know all that you've done on my behalf.
The Regents are treating these charges seriously. They wanted to hear from you. Can't you bring yourself to write them an explanation? A public airing will not be good for the university.
Wells chose a public forum to start all this. I'm going to answer him in public.
If the Regents should decide to dismiss you, I would be powerless to help you.
I understand that, President Adams. But I insist that this man stand up in public, show himself, speak his mind. Then I shall speak mine.
I admire your stand, Richard.
It's not I who will be on trial.
Gentlemen. I have here in my hand a copy of the letter upon which this hearing is based. It's the letter of Mr. Wells of July 5th, 1894, published in the Nation July 12th. In this letter, I find there are two specific charges made against Professor Ely. The first charge is that Professor Ely, and I quote, believes in strikes and boycotts, justifying and encouraging the one while practicing the other. The second charge, and I quote again, a careful reading of his books will disclose the same principle. Only the careful student will discover their utopian, impractical, or pernicious doctrines.
Professor Ely.
As his attorney, I will answer for Professor Ely. In answer to the charges in the letter of Mr. Wells, Professor Ely denies them separately and together. Denies, in fact, one and all the charges made in Mr. Wells' letter.
The audience will desist from further demonstration. This investigation will be conducted in a proper manner.
Well, why not begin with the first charge? That he believes in strikes and boycotts.
The charge states that a careful reading of the books will show this.
Our instructions are to investigate Professor Ely's teachings.
What Professor Ely has written represents what he thinks. It must therefore affect what he teaches.
I have here one quote. I think it is from the North American Review. An article written by him in the March issue. Here it is. I quote, "It cuts me to the heart when laboring men are shot down in the street." Now, if that bias is what Professor Ely feels, that bias is what he is going to teach.
Please, the committee, I object to this taking of words out of context.
Well, it's your privilege to introduce other portions of his work.
But the damage has been done, sir. The public only sees the accusation. They don't get to read the whole paragraph.
And it becomes a cruel injustice to a man who, instead of teaching that kind of doctrine, is teaching a doctrine of moderation and conservatism.
Well, I don't see any other way to do it.
I suggest that we get on with the proof of the specific charges, starting with the one encouraging strikes and boycotts.
Can you get on with the specific charges?
Yes, sir. I have my witnesses.
Please invite them in.
Why did you object to the quotation? That's what I said. I stand by it.
But it indicates bias. It could hurt you.
Mr. Tracy. You are connected with a printing establishment in Madison, are you not?
Yes, sir.
What is the company?
Tracy Gibbs and Company.
There was a strike in that office last year, was there not?
Yes, sir, there was.
Now, was that strike talked about or threatened before it occurred?
Yes, for some weeks, I think.
During the time of that strike, or immediately preceding or following it, had Professor Ely any conversation with you respecting the strike?
Yes, sir. Before, during, and after.
Can you remember that first conversation?
Yes, sir. Dr. Ely advised me to make my office a union office. He stated that his society, meaning the Christian Social Union for whom we were doing the printing might require him to take the printing away and take it to a union office because they believed in the union.
Now, this Christian Union of which he spoke, Dr. Ely was secretary of that organization, was he not?
Yes, sir, I believe he was.
What did you say to him?
Well, sir, I told him that if I was to adopt a union, I would be doing a great injustice to many other worthy men. And I gave him an example. Here are two men, both seeking employment. We need a skilled man. Here is a man who is unclean and unskilled, a profligate man, without a home or friends, a man who is offensive, but he is a union member. Standing beside him is a clean, skilled man, a man with a little family, a man who has been made unfortunate by illness, a man who is conscientious and scrupulous in his labor. But for some reason, he has not joined a union. Perhaps he is a relative of mine. I would be debarred from hiring him. I would be compelled to hire the dirty, unskilled man instead of the clean, skilled one.
And what did Dr. Ely say to that?
Dr. Ely said the other man should join the union.
But if he did not, you should hire the dirty, dissipated, unmarried, unreliable, unskilled man.
Oh, Jack.
In preference.
Jack. The counsel is putting words in Dr. Ely's mouth.
I withdraw the implication. Just another question or two, Mr. Tracy. Your office never did become a union office, did it?
No, sir. Never has been.
Does, Dr. Ely have his printing done at your office now?
No, sir. He does not.
Your witness.
Mr. Tracy, it is true, isn't it, that Professor Ely continued his printing with your office throughout the strike?
Yes, sir.
And after the strike?
For a while.
How long a while?
3 or 4 months.
Then you have no certain knowledge that Professor Ely removed his printing from your office because yours was a non-union office.
I have no such knowledge as that at all.
You and Professor Ely had a little misunderstanding, did you not, with regards to some printing bills toward the last?
I would hardly call it a misunderstanding.
Well, you had a difference.
Yes, sir.
And you exchanged a few words on the subject.
We talked about it, if you call that a few
words. Well, it is true, is it not, Mr. Tracy, that there was some small feeling growing out of some printing affairs?
Well, I will just have to tell you what it is. Dr. Ely had considerable feeling at the time.
And you had none?
No, sir. I simply wanted our money.
Thank you.
Colonel Byrd?
Nothing more, sir.
Mr. Jones?
Nothing.
That will be all, Mr. Tracy.
How's it look? He admitted I didn't say what they charged. But you do advocate trade unions. That may be an upper admission for them.
Mr. Reynolds, you were connected with the strikes that were held here last year, were you not?
Yes, sir.
In what capacity?
I was a striker at the Democrat Printing Company.
Are you acquainted with a Mr. Clunk from Kansas City?
Yes, sir. He's what they call a walking delegate. He's a member of the National Typographical Union.
He came to this city during the strikes.
Yes, sir, to help us organize the plants.
Now, Mr. Reynolds, do you know of any connection while he was here between Mr. Clunk and Professor Ely?
Mm,
Well, I know that Mr. Clunk had dinner or supper with some professor at the university. Do you believe that was Dr. Ely? Yes.
How did you know that Clunk had dinner with someone?
Well, the way I got that information was, I was in a crowd where this man Clunk was, and someone said something about him having dinner or supper with some professor.
Someone said something about some professor?
Yes, sir.
Was there any conversation in the crowd as to who the professor was?
Oh, well, I don't think his name was mentioned, but I remember when reading the articles in the newspaper, I supposed it was Dr. Ely.
Isn't it a fact, Mr. Reynolds, that all the information you've been reporting here is not from your own sense of sight or hearing, but from the loose conversations of other men?
Well, I couldn't say for certain it was a professor.
And you have no certain knowledge that it was Professor Ely?
No.
That is all.
That'll be all, Mr. Reynolds. You may present your case, Mr. Jones.
I would like to place in evidence several testimonials received by Dr. Ely in this recent period.
Well, are they pertinent?
If I may read from them, you can judge for yourselves. From President Andrews of Brown University. For your noble university to depose Professor Ely would be a great blow at freedom of university teaching in general and at the development of political economy in particular. From President Charles Kendall Adams of the University of Wisconsin, speaking of Professor Ely's book on socialism. From beginning to end, there is not a paragraph or sentence that can be interpreted as an encouragement of lawlessness or disorder.
Accepted.
Another piece of evidence, if you will. This is a continuation of the quotation given by Mr. Wells about Dr. Ely being cut to the heart when laborers are shot down in the street. The next sentences are as follows. All the wars have been made at the expense of your blood. Imitate no violence. Destruction of the property or lives of others cannot help you or enrich you. Your triumph can come only by peace. Hardly a call to insurrection. Now a word is to private property. Private property is one of the main incentives to thrift and industry, and thus is beneficial to society as a whole, as well as to the individual. Hardly the words of a socialist. And the quotations are not taken out of context. They represent the man, the whole man, and the patriotic man.
I'm going to put you on the stand now. So just answer my questions. Say nothing more.
When you finish with your questions, I'd like to make a statement.
To the board? Out of the question. Now listen to me. I don't know these men on this board. But if they are fair-minded men, when I get through presenting your case...
I will not allow Wells get away with this.
Forget Wells. There's going to be one winner and one loser. Think of yourself.
I merely wish to state that what Mr. Wells has done is evil, that's all.
You'd lose every chance you have.
Are you prepared to continue, Mr. Jones?
Yes, sir. Will Dr. Ely take the stand, please? Professor Ely, you heard the testimony of Mr. Tracy. Did you take away from Mr. Tracy any printing by reason of the fact that his office was not a union office?
No.
Did you ever say to Mr. Tracy or any other person that where a skilled worker was needed, that a dirty, dissipated, unskilled, unreliable, unmarried tramp, if a union man, should be employed in preference to a skillful non-union man who was the head of a family?
No. Now, Professor, you've heard during this investigation of one Mr. Clunk of Kansas City.
Yes. Did you ever meet this gentleman?
Never.
Did you meet with any other union representative or striker during the period of the recent labor troubles?
I did not.
Now, Professor, how long have you been a teacher of economics?
13 years.
And what views do you teach in the classroom regarding anarchy?
I oppose it as the worst thing that could ever happen to this country.
Thank you, Dr. Ely.
No questions. You may step down, Dr. Ely.
I should like to make a statement, if I may.
Yes, of course.
Don't do it, Ely. Look at their faces. They're for you now. Don't turn them against you. Step down.
May we proceed, please?
Mr. Wells has given quotations from my work to depict me as a man of certain beliefs. Mr. Jones has offered quotations to prove the opposite, I suppose, as in any trial.
This is not a trial, Dr. Ely. This is a hearing.
In any case, the judges will finally decide which is really the man. Is he the heretic or is he the patriot? You see, I happen to be both. Mr. Wells is wrong in his facts, but absolutely right in his suspicions. I am his enemy, and I shall continue to be his enemy, whether I stay at Wisconsin or whether I do not. For I consider Mr. Wells as dangerous as he considers me. He is a bigot. And if allowed power, he will put such fear into our public institutions that no one will dare investigate the truth. Free inquiry will disappear, and with it, democracy. My heresy to Mr. Wells is that I teach all sides of a question, even socialism, that most evil of questions. I confess that heresy. As a teacher, I insist upon it. And if that is what is meant by corrupting young minds, then the more young minds are corrupted that way, the healthier this country is going to be. As to my own views, I have nothing to retract. I may have modified my opinions. But in the main, the views I now hold, I have held for years. I believe in social solidarity. I believe that we shall have no true prosperity in this country so long as there is any class of the population materially and morally wretched. I believe that ideas govern the world and that the mind of man is a free creative force and its direction determined by education. I believe in the idea of liberty in a democracy. And I believe that if that idea of liberty is to survive, it must be based on universal love and human brotherhood. Unless this happens, our material triumphs will mean nothing. Our nation will inevitably go the way of all the great empires of the past. Thank you. Subject is government regulation of private industry. I found it helpful with these questions to start off with a sort of debate, with some students on one side and some on the other. Now, who'll be against it? Who'll be for the motion? No, I will not allow it. You will not wait for the region's report before deciding whether or not to keep your minds open. Not in my classroom. You. I promise you that lightning will not strike you dead if you argue the benefits of government regulation. I can also promise you that you will be dead from the neck up if you let caution turn off your brains. Did you read the assignment?
Yes, sir.
Why is government regulation a good thing?
It prevents monopoly.
It creates monopoly.
It's better for the consumer.
Why?
Well, it's not just for private profit.
Well, what's wrong with private profit? This country was built on it.
Think!
That's what you're here for. You're here to learn. You can't learn unless you think.
Don't be afraid. Let your minds bring you forward.
Regions Committee of Investigation. I think you gentlemen may be interested to hear what it says. As regents of the university, we could not for a moment think of recommending the dismissal or even the criticism of a teacher, even if some of his opinions should, in some quarters, be regarded as visionary. Such a course would be equivalent to saying that no professor should teach anything which is not accepted by everybody as true. We cannot believe that knowledge has reached its final goal, or that the present condition of society is perfect. In all lines of academic investigation, therefore, it is of the utmost importance that the investigator should be absolutely free to follow the indications of the truth, wherever they may lead. Whatever may be the limitations which trammel inquiry elsewhere, we believe the great state university of Wisconsin should ever encourage that continual and fearless sifting and winnowing by which alone the truth can be found. Let's get on with the sifting and winnowing.
This became the Magna Carta of academic freedom in the United States, a tribute to the stand Richard T. Ely took that day, and to the bankers, lawyers, and businessmen of the Wisconsin Board of Regents.
These stories of past courage can teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.
The use of this additional story of a courageous American was approved by President Kennedy for this series. In a moment, a preview of the next episode.